bad guys never think they're bad guys.
Villains are a lot more fun.
And all the blood that went flying around was just a kind of gravy on the cake. Gravy on the cake. There was that particular street in Dallas, and it was a neighborhood, I guess, that was scheduled to be torn down anyway. And we really tore it down and blew it up and smashed it and destroyed it completely.
I like it!
We had these big, big cannons that they designed for us. We got very, very used to hauling them around and shooting them. And they made really gloriously big explosions.
It's primarily a gun that's intended to be fired on a tripod. It's not intended to be picked up and carried around, unless you're Arnold Schwarzenegger, but he wasn't in this movie, so.
We had some phony ones that were like made out of a kind of a styrofoam material.
Sometimes we would be using the dummy, and the dummy, of course, weighed nothing. So then that's when the acting came in, because then you had to make it look as heavy as the real one did, so you didn't look too stupid all of a sudden. Because every time we had to like fire it, it had to obviously be the real gun.
Paul was always for new ideas, and if we could destroy something in a better way, he was all for it. Explosions are memorable to me. The one where Clarence Boddicker and I are leaning up against the car, and that whole big storefront explodes into a fiery mass.
So the thing was that whatever the cue was, we go across the street, and then they blow it. This big fireball comes out and follows us.
There were little pieces of debris that embedded themselves in the right side of my face in that one.
It got to my coat, and my coat, you know, my coat was smoldering. They came and ran, pulled the coat off, you know, and you could feel the heat, but I didn't really realize it was getting to my clothes.
And I believe they gave me a stunt adjustment for that.
They came and said, well, we hadn't intended for it to be quite that big an explosion. We're sorry about it, so we've decided we wanted to give you stunt pay, you know.
After I got that extra $300 or $400, I tried to devise ways where I could get closer to the explosions.
It was just a great summer. Summer of 86. You know, we were all in the same hotel. We'd all hang out in the same bar afterwards.
We went to dinner together most of the time.
It was like the best summer camp ever.
Downtown Dallas, at least 1986, it wasn't really anything down there. You know, 5 o'clock and everybody left town, and that was pretty much it, you know. There's tumbleweeds blowing through the street and, you know, and actors wandering around looking for something to do. We pretty much hung out together, and I think that feeling played onto the set as well. You know, we really kind of like felt like a unit, you know, and we had fun doing what we were doing.
It was a fairly young group, and we were pretty boisterous, as I recall.
Paul just let us go crazy.
I remember that when we were at the steel mill, that's when we were really bored, because we were in our third or fourth month of the film, and we were in Manesson, Pennsylvania, and there was nothing there. There was nothing to do, and we used to steal the golf carts, you know, that the ADs use.
Yeah, you couldn't leave a golf cart around us.
We would steal them and have races around the steel mill. And then the ADs were constantly angry at us, you know, and trying to find their golf carts. And they didn't think it was funny at all.
We were just like little boys playing in a big sandbox.
Yeah.
I just liked Leon's style. One day I came in and read for Paul Verhoeven. And then I think he felt that I could be one of the good bad guys. I liked the way he dressed, and I liked that little piece of jewelry that he had of the eyeball. I also felt that he was probably the best looking of the bunch.
Don't touch me, man!
He knew how to have a good time, old Leon did.
Can you fly, Bobby?
Clarence, no!
Actually, they brought me in for Dick Jones and for Clarence.
I always wanted to play Clarence, you know. And Kurtwood did a wonderful job, and I'm not taking anything away from him, but I sure would have liked to have had a shot at that one.
I read the script pretty quickly and thought, oh, you know, B-movie, but fun. Looks like it's be real fun. I didn't know who the director was, didn't know anything about it, just went in and read. My agent called, and I had the part. And I thought she was talking about Dick Jones when we were, like, working out the details and stuff. And then she said something. I said, wait a minute, what part is this? She said, well, it's Clarence. For me, to be getting to do something a little bit different was very exciting. I can't remember where along the line I found out about the reason that I had been cast and exactly what they were looking for.
I had to refer to things I knew about from Europe, isn't it? I mean, I grew up in Second World War and Heinrich Himmler was the head of the SS in Germany. I thought the prototype of a criminal is Heinrich Himmler for me. Clarence Boddicker should look a little bit with Heinrich Himmler, and that was the little glasses we gave him, you know.
He was smart, and that's always scary. If you see some kind of big bruiser in a movie and this and that, you always figure you can outsmart him. But when somebody's really cold-hearted bad guy who can also think, then you know you're in trouble, and then it's a little terrifying.
Clarence Boddicker was a guy who was about shotguns and hand grenades and was kind of a pretty tough guy that way and didn't care about killing innocent people at all.
I felt that it was essential that Clarence be a character who never backs off, and he had a sense of humor. Now, it's a macabre sense of humor. It was a vicious sense of humor. Sense of humor. I wanted Clarence to have more of a revolutionary look than a street gang leader look. We just went shopping. We went to army surplus stores and then high-end eyeglasses stores and fashion stores where we'd get like really expensive boots.
Kurtwood Smith was extremely creative, I felt, you know, and a lot of his ideas we used.
Kurtwood used to come to the set and just have some ideas, and they would always be good.
The first scene I ever shot in the movie was when RoboCop drags me in and throws me on the desk and says, book him. And I was supposed to just say, give me my phone call. I went up to Paul just before we shot it and said, well, what if I spit blood on the desk and then say, give me my fucking phone call? And Paul goes, you want to spit blood? Yes, let's try it.
Yeah, I was immediately a fan of that, clearly, isn't it? My style includes basically that these kind of disgusting things.
Well, I didn't really know at that point, because it was my first day, I didn't know what a sort of blood freak Paul was with regard to the movie, as we found out later.
Just give me my fucking phone call.
The corporate villains, we really enjoyed writing. These are people who are clearly out of touch with reality. They only live above the 50th floor.
It's a better plan. Fucking Jones. I'd go straight to the old man if I could.
Don't mess with Jones, man. He'll make sushi out of
it. Is Bob Morton a villain? I guess he's an up-and-coming villain who doesn't quite get his day.
Bob Morton is a terrific role. The guy was just deliciously avaricious. He was just fantastic. He was like every Hollywood junior agent you've ever met. The casting director for RoboCop was a woman named Sally Dennison, who I'd known for a while, and she wanted me to come in and read for one of the gang guys. And I read the script, and I said, you know, I'd love to do that for you, but I'd really rather do this other guy, this executive guy. And she said, oh, I never would have thought of you for that, but okay. So weeks passed, and I figured it had all been forgotten, and I finally got a chance to go in and met Paul and everyone, and then I came back a second time, me and just one other guy, and, you know, it worked out.
Perhaps you're aware of the RoboCop program developed by myself at Security Concepts as a contingency against just this sort of thing?
In the script, he was supposed to look kind of like a nerd or a loser before the Ed 209 incident, before he proposed the RoboCop, and then after he was successful, Ed Neumeier's idea was to really have a radically different look, and we didn't find a way to really make that work.
The very first scene we shot in the entire picture was the bathroom scene.
Ronnie and I really had an idea of how to do this, which is the way it sort of played out on screen, to make it almost like a seduction in the beginning. He grabs my hair. We showed it to Paul, and Paul just loved it. He said, that's very sick, isn't it? Yes, I like it.
You just fucked with the wrong guy.
Ready? Fucking mind.
It was Ronnie's idea to really have that turn on it instead of a straight-ahead confrontation, which was interesting.
I think it's one of the most powerful scenes, and I think it sets his character up in a really good way, and I think it sets my character up in a really good way.
I think the character of Bob Morton is definitely pissed, but definitely scared. Because when Ronnie says you just fucked with the wrong guy, it's, you know, he's seen some bodies buried before. But I think his overriding greed and confidence actually makes him believe that he's going to get away with it because he's smarter. So, I mean, the guy really got to do everything. He started out in the beginning of the movie as really quite an underdog, took an opportunity, rose to power, success. His life changed. All of a sudden he had money and girls, nice clothes. And then it all went south on him.
I'm cashing you out.
My agents had called me up and said, Ronnie, would you like to go in and do this film? And I got to tell you, my agent said, I don't think it's a very good film. But it said, it's a chance for you to play a villain. I'd spent my whole career playing Mr. Nice Guy and had always played just the sensitive fellow next door. Since I had been in a number of films where I've always played sort of sympathetic guys, it gave us the element of surprise, which is always my favorite, because so many times with villains, you sort of know where they're coming from. And with me playing him, you sort of wanted to try to like him at first, and then there was nothing to like. Oddly enough, with Dick Jones, I looked for every good thing about him. I always looked for the opposites. When I played all of those sympathetic nice guys, I always looked for the rough edges on those guys. And with Dick Jones, I just looked at this, and I really sort of looked at the world through his prism. I bought into what he was saying, and then once I did that, I tried to play him as simply and as straightforwardly as possible. Obviously, Ed 209 was far superior to RoboCop. I mean, everybody knows that. I mean, of course, it had a couple of design flaws, but we can work that out.
I'm sure it's only a glitch, a temporary setback.
The only guy I'm worried about here is the old man. Guys like you, no worries.
I got him, Clarence! I got him!
Well, in RoboCop, I get blown up to smithereens. And there's nothing left of me. And you know, there was a dummy up there, up in that crane control booth. And, but dressed in my clothes. So when they actually blew him up, and then they took the tattered clothes off the dummy and gave them to me. I still have them. They hang in my closet, in my room, in my bedroom, wrapped in plastic, like Laura Palmer was.
Those explosions knocked me down, and actually made me physically ill. I wasn't, you know, I've had squibs 1,000 times in movies. Never anything quite like that.
So finally, when he gets me in the neck, then what they had done was they ran a hose from way over there. That was the other thing, is while I was staggering around in the water overacting up a storm, I had to make sure I didn't pull my hose, because the hose had the blood in it and it ran under the water, you know, up my pants, legs, up my wrist. So when I grabbed it right here, there, all the blood that's is pumping out of my wrist, actually, and onto my neck.
The moment among villains I thought worked best was when Bob Morton was killed. He's there with the two call girls and the cocaine, and Clarence shows up with the DVD of Dick Jones, giving him the speech about how he has to die. So you have three villains in one place.
You know, Paul is Dutch, and Joost Vacano, the cinematographer, is German. And
I don't believe that Paul knew during that evening that bitches was a pejorative term for females.
We were getting ready to do the scene, and so we were kind of blocking it out, and Paul says, Kurtwood says, bitches leave, then the bitches leave, and bitches, then you leave, when he says that. And then he says, no, wait, bitches, don't leave, wait. Joost, what do you think? Should bitches leave when he says, bitches leave, or should they wait for him to make a motion? Joost goes, the bitches should leave. Yeah, bitches. Bitches, you leave. Miguel and I are just sitting there cracking up. And the bitches, they didn't seem to have a problem with it at all. You know, they were like, okay, fine, sure.
Very good. Thank you, bitches. Very good. That's a wrap on the bitches. Thank you very much, bitches.
I couldn't resist sticking my tongue in the ring and pulling it out with my teeth.
This is the second time that Kurtwood had killed me in a movie. And, you know, it's been 20 years, and I really think it's time for me to kill him.
Flashpoint Miguel is in, and I kill him in that movie, too. So he has sworn vengeance on me.
Gotta try to make that happen. This movie absolutely changed my life.
It's done well for me. I mean, it opened doors at that time. It
didn't make me much money for a long time.
I don't think any of us knew how well it would turn out. I think everyone was surprised.
It made me sort of a character actor to be seen at auditions. And, you know, when you're looking for people, then, you know, I became one of those people. In this business, acting, especially character acting, you need to have a good role in a successful film.
It was fun playing that guy.
God bless that robot movie.
Thank you.